How's it going, everybody? Thanks for tuning in and watching today's video. This is the last video in the kayak camping vlog series before I head out for my trip tomorrow. I've been working all day today, getting the boat ready, going through packing all the stuff and making sure it's gonna fit, going over my gear and checking everything and just making sure that I've got what I need. And if I've got more than what I need, then so be it. This is kind of the battle that I faced last year, and it's just not something that I'm going to win. So the beginning of this, I showed you everything that's left. It looks like a whole lot, but really these are very small or smaller dry bags, and there's just not a lot of stuff in there. It's just me wanting to be organized and keep things separated so that I have a mental checklist of I only need to grab one thing to get this done. I just hate digging through and having to pull stuff out once you've got it packed and it works. So I have tried and put all this in the boat. I'll show you that footage here in a little bit. That way you can see how all this fits and how I actually pack my kayak. The only thing that I don't have ready is I've got to go pick up two longer bungee straps, because the two that I used last year I cannot find. So you'll see me just kind of rigging something together to make it work just for the demonstration purposes. But let me get to what's on the table here. I'm going to try to speed through this. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below and I'll be glad to answer them. I'm leaving tomorrow morning. Going to get to the area probably around 2-3 o'clock at the latest, and then we head out early in the morning on Friday at 8 a.m. So let's look at what's on the table. All right, let's get the fun stuff out of the way so that if you're tired of watching these videos and you're bored to death by them by now, you will at least see close to the beginning what I'm taking as far as tools.
He's got a knife.
That's not a knife. That's a knife.
So we'll go over this first. This is the LT Wright Overland Machete. Yes, it's carbon steel. Yes, it's going to rust if it gets wet, but this will be in my dry storage, in between my legs, inside my boat. So if it rusts, it's a tool. I'm not worried about it. It'll probably just be surface rust. I'll actually post a picture right here. That is from my first kayak trip when we did 47 miles, and I took my LT Wright Genesis that's A2 steel on that trip. One, to see how the A2 steel would handle up around water, and two, to see how a leather sheath that was untreated and just stock from the company would hold up. So that's a picture of that, and it's pretty gruesome. But to let you know, it cleaned up fine. It actually put a really cool patina on it, and it never did any kind of damage or pitting or corrosion to it. So this is my LT Wright Machete. I've got some extra shock cord here in case this wears out, which it's still holding strong. And I've got a ferro rod attached right here. So this will definitely be put to use on some campsites. I can almost guarantee it. There's gonna be some with vines and twigs and sticks and all kinds of stuff. And I'll probably be passing this around to the guys that don't have a machete so they can clear their campsites out. Next is my knife. This will be on my belt and my hip the whole time. It's got the same kind of ferro rod. It's just a smaller one. I've got a little bit of shock cord here on the end to keep it in there because it's smaller than a loop. All right, so I'll just tell you real quick two things about this setup. Both I have like customized a little bit than what they originally were. The sheath, not only did I wet form it a little while back, and yes, that's a burn mark from the tray. The oven got a little too hot. It's super hard and stout, but what I did to it was I saturated this in birch oil. I saturated it in birch oil, went over it with the hairdryer, and it literally soaked it in. You can kind of see the difference between the regular sheath and the inside of the belt loop here, because I didn't really treat this belt loop much. It needs to be flexible anyways, but the parts that I didn't want to turn into a noodle, I treated with birch oil. It darkened it. It really smells of birch oil, and I have already tested it. in the sink as far as holding it underwater, and it beads the water off pretty well. So like that picture I showed you of the Genesis, I took that Genesis with a plain leather untreated sheath, and yes, the sheath turned into a wet noodle, but I put the knife in it every night and all during the day. It was never like I just left it there and it bent or formed crazy. Is I kept the knife in there, so it stayed formed around the knife. Then whenever I got home, I just reformed it, and it worked out fine. So this birch oil is definitely going to help it a lot. I don't know if it's actually going to keep it waterproof, but I just didn't have time to get Kydex made for this. So it is what it is. It'll be a good test. I'll let you know how it goes. The knife is a custom GNS. So I did a video a while back. I'll put the link in the description. And it was on the AEBL GNS stainless steel knife in a full convex grind. And it was right whenever they came out with when LT Wright started making those. And they made them in 3/32. It's got a full convex. And it's actually AEBL stainless. When I was up in Ohio last year, LT pulled this one out from a fancy tray. Now, I didn't see it, and he showed me all these fancy knives, and I knew that I had to have it. It's a Coke bottle shape, like almost a Woodlore clone style with pretty blue liners. So originally this had a brown polished micarta scales. I have since used sandpaper and taken off the polish and have made it more of a natural feel. And then I actually rubbed birch oil on this too, and it's given it a nice grippy, tacky feel, but it doesn't come off on your hands. It's not sticky on your hands. It's just on the blade. So this is a stainless knife. Last year I took the same knife, just a different handle, and it was incredible. The thin blade yields itself very well to filleting fish and slicing rope and all the things that you'd expect to do on a water. And with it having a convex edge, it just held up fabulously. So this is something I'm really excited to get. And then I put a lanyard on it the way that I like to do it. I put a split lanyard on it so it doesn't get snagged on anything. And then whenever I actually want it to be a lanyard, I pull the bead down, and now I've got a lanyard. And there's no way that bead's coming out. I melt the two ends together in a way that it can't pull through that bead anymore. So that's the blade I'm taking, and it will be on my hip the whole time. And I'm not worried about the leather, especially now that I've treated it with birch oil. If it messes up, then I'll just re-wet form it when I get back. So now that the fun stuff is over, we will work through this. There's not really a lot here, but I just wanted to actually show you everything I'm taking. My sunglasses, these were cheap ones that I got from Bass Pro. I think they're like $7.95, but they're polarized. And I got one of the little neck lanyard things. This was like $3. Next is the Gore-Tex hat I showed you. This is what I'll be wearing on my head majority of the time. I might wear a ball cap. It just depends on what the weather's like. This is a daisy chained piece of tubular webbing. I've got a fixed loop down here on the end that you can easily pull out or hook onto something. And then this is all daisy chained. And this is something very handy to have for a trip like this. If I need to throw it out to somebody, if I need to, you know, hook it up to my kayak to tow it, this is just, it's very handy for me to have. And I'll probably lash this on the boat and stick it behind my seat. This is an empty dry bag. It's empty because the camera equipment, the microphone, a battery, my cell phone that I film with, my wallet, the things that I can't lose will go in this dry bag. And then I tether it. It's got a little loop on the end, and I tether this to the handle on my kayak. And that way, when it's time to paddle and I'm not filming or fishing or whatever, I put all the stuff in here, roll it down real quick, and start paddling. It's worked really well for me the past 2 years, and it's just something I really like. This little dry bag goes right behind my calf while I'm sitting in the boat. All right, this dry bag is my cooking implements. As soon as I open it, I have the Keith titanium nonstick skillet. I got this a little while back. and I've actually been using it quite a lot at home. The non-stick part of the skillet works very well. It cleans out very easily. This weighs next to nothing. The handle folds out. It's super light. It's just going to be perfect for those packet gourmet meals, like the eggs and all that, that require a skillet to cook them in. And this will help me if I catch some fish and I want to fry those fish. I can put some of that ghee butter in here, fry the fish up. It's just something nice to have, a little skillet. And with this not weighing anything, and it literally fits right in a dry bag, it's a no-brainer for me. Next up, I have two rags. One of these will be to clean stuff with, and this other dirty one, or it looks dirty, it's actually clean, it's just stained. This will be to wipe my stuff out with down at the river and to kind of scrub stuff with. Next is my folding windscreen. It's the tall one because the stove that I use, it sits up higher. I got this off of Amazon. Next is a little cutting board. This was part of the trash can that I cut the front of it out for my Frost River Royale modification video. And it works really well for a cutting board or a little plate. You can clean fish and stuff on here. Super lightweight, and it just slides down the back of the dry bag. I've got a spare spork or titanium spoon spork thing. This little measuring cup, these fold down to nothing, and they actually can work as a coffee cup, or I can use this, if I'm not using it for coffee, I can actually use this to scoop out water from the river and fill up my Sawyer bags, so that it's a lot easier to fill those Sawyer squeeze bags up with something like this. It's got a pour spout on the front of it. Next up is a little GSI plate scraper cleaner thing. This works really well for all the nooks and crannies. It's got a soft edge and a hard edge. It weighs nothing. I really like it. It works really well. I also have one of the pocket bellows in case we have a fire, or I've got my Firebox Nano stove in my other bag over here that's in my mother carrier. Fat wood and another folding cup. I really like containers, and it just helps to have them in case somebody forgot theirs or something happens. So these two things just weigh nothing and they slide right down. A spare big lighter. And then I have the biggest item in the kit, and this is a wax canvas pouch. Sitting on top of this is a little like Sammy style wax canvas pouch. I've got some individual coffees in here, a couple pieces of chaga, and then some actual like non-instant fresh ground coffee in case we want to get real crazy and make some cowboy coffee and let the grains float to the bottom. In this wax canvas bag is my Pathfinder bush pot. This is strictly the coffee maker. This is what I make all the coffee in. I've done it every year since we've started doing this, and it's just really handy for a huge group like this. I've got a really cool kettle, but it doesn't hold as much water. So in here, I have my Burton brew that I mix up. All right, so Burton brew, for everyone that wants to know, this was something that got tagged the first time that we went. I think it was either Travis or Mr. Major that, or maybe Justin Wolf, I can't remember, but somebody called it the Burton brew. We loved it. We drank it every day. So it's just kind of a little instant coffee recipe that I came up with. So you want to get your instant coffee a choice. Get the biggest jar you can find. For a while, I was using Nescafe. I've actually found out that a lot of people don't like it. I can't really tell a difference. But the last couple of years, I've been using Instant Coffee by Maxwell House. And then you buy a pack of the Starbucks Via, either the Columbia brew or the Pike's Place. It's whichever one you want. And I put all of those packets in here. And then the kicker that makes it taste better than most coffee you've had at campfires, even though it's instant coffee, the kicker is I crack a healthy portion of sea salt into the coffee and shake it all up. So there's actually sea salt in here. And the reason I do that is for people that don't really like strong coffee, but they like the flavor of it. Sea salt takes the bitterness and the bite away from strong coffee. So you can actually drink pretty stout oil coffee and and handle it because the sea salt will take the bite away. So that's sitting on top. And then all I have underneath is a spare fuel canister from our stove. And then my beloved coffee scoop. This is a handmade birch scoop that I got in Alaska. It says Alaskan birch on there. And a gentleman was selling these and he hand carves these. So this is something that's near and dear to me. Okay, so this dry bag is one that I might actually be taking stuff out of or changing in the next few hours or so, like, you know, tonight, later, or something before I leave out tomorrow. This is kind of just like odds and ends and stuff that I feel more comfortable bringing, but I know I don't necessarily have to have or need. Okay, so in the top is my Hidden Woodsman Possibles pouch. And in here is just stuff that I just tend to always have in my day kit, so it's kind of hard for me to not want to bring it with me. And I'm bringing my Hidden Woodsman haversack that's in my main backpack, my dry bag here, that I can pull out if we go on a day hike or something, and this is just something I can grab and put in there. But I've got my compass, a small roll of duct tape, another like little piece of fat wood with some duct tape on it, Dragonfire Tinderbox Fireball, a hank of paracord, a piece for prussic knots, my Leatherman OHT multi-tool, a random carabiner, a tick twister key, another hank of cord, some bank line, a small dog bone ceramic sharpener. This will definitely be handy if someone needs it, and then just an orange bandana. Next, I have my Snug Pack Patrol Poncho. This is something that's handy if someone needs it. I can't not bring it. Next, I have my Centerline Systems G-Roll. This is a Gen 2. In here is, again, a lot of the stuff that I just always bring with me. So in this first pouch, I have my Heavy Cover Titanium Spork, my Charmin baby wipes, some big ones, wet ones to clean off with, and just some random bank line. In this second pocket, I've got my leather work gloves I always bring, my Baco, and nothing else in that pocket. And then in this bottom pocket is just the straps that was sent with the G-Roll that I can hook this up to the mother carrier if I want. All right, next is the core backpack that's going to be going behind me. Outside of it, I have a smart water bottle and another style bottle of the Life Water or whatever it's called. They're both like heavier plastic. They don't dent as easy. And one of them I can use to fill up my Sawyer bags quicker or to just have a lightweight extra drinking container. All right, so this is just set up for my first night. I'm going to be staying at a hotel close by before we start the trip. So I've just got stuff that I can grab and take this with me when I go into the hotel. In the top, I've got my toiletries kit. I've already gone over this with you. And then my little planner. It's called the EDO by Centerline Systems, and it's also what I'm going to use as a map case. It opens up and you can store your pens, and then I'm going to put my maps inside here. So those won't actually be in this dry bag whenever I'm on the river. I'll move this into one of my clothing bags or something, and the EDO map case will be in a dry bag that's by my leg. So I have this set up to where everything that I need immediate access to is in the top. My Gore-Tex jacket, my Gore-Tex pants, my Sawyer water filter system. I've got two 64 ounce bags, the Sawyer Mini and the syringe. My butane stove. This is the Optimus Crux stove, not the Crux Light. It folds down and sits under the canister, and then this little bungee goes over the top. A neck gaiter, my Centerline Systems mother carrier. Right now it's empty, but I'll be drinking out of this. I'll just leave this open and pull the canteen out. Inside here I have the canteen, the cup, the lid, and a scour pad underneath. And then in the back pocket I've got my Firebox Nano And then literally in these pouches, I just have those Mayo water flavoring drink mixes with some of them electrolytes and all that. That's the only thing that's in these pouches here. And then pretty much in the bottom, I've got this little ditty bag or whatever, and this is just batteries, camera stuff. Like, actually, I've got my Bible and then the batteries. So I've got this battery that's charged and this anchor battery and a little little lantern that I can put in the tent. And then that's a guitar tuner, because I am bringing a little small 3/4 guitar. My headlamp, and then the anchor solar panel. I'm bringing more than one battery because I do all the filming with my phone. And since my phone's an older phone, the iPhone 6 Plus, the battery's starting to wear out on it. And on my, I actually have the Mophie case too, so that's a battery. And most of the time, by the end of the day, I'm already turning on the Mophie case to charge my phone again and to tap into that battery. So it takes twice as long for me to charge my phone because I'm charging two batteries, the Mophie case battery and the actual battery on my phone. So that's why I brought more than one battery. Most random piece of gear, a super lightweight, cheap plastic spatula. This is for my titanium skillet so it doesn't scratch it up. Tin Woodsman haversack rolled up. Don't even know if I'll be using this or not, but it's a nice piece of kit to bring. JB's Outdoor Supply hammock chair. I'll use this more of like a ground pad to sit on or to put in front of the vegetable in my tent. That is how I loaded my boat. That is how I get everything in the boat and how I float on the river. It's really not that hard. I'm very fortunate to have a boat that can handle that weight for the amount of gear that I have. It's able to pack very easily. I've got a lot of dry storage, so I don't have to have a lot of stuff on the outside of my boat. And it rides very well. It's not heavy in the front. It doesn't drag. The way the boat's made is just genius. It can go in like six inches of water, and I just really, really enjoy it. Yeah, that's what I do for a kayak trip like this, 130 miles over 6 days. I appreciate you watching the videos. I know they dragged on for a little while in some of them, and they weren't the funnest, but you know, I think it's really good for me to actually go back and see the videos that I did last year and what all I brought and then changed stuff. So try to get a weight to show you everything that that weighs. I'll just add it all up. I'll put that right here.
So I weigh 233 pounds. I would hold each dry bag and I would take that weight and subtract it from 233 pounds. The numbers on the right are what the dry bags weigh, and my total weight of all my gear was 81.5 pounds.
Oh, it's really not that much when I'm thinking about living out of your boat for 6 days, and I don't know, I don't mind it. But thank you for watching the videos. I appreciate all the likes and the comments. I love interacting with you. Don't forget to get outside and enjoy the woods.